up to the studios, but thanks for making the trip. Florence Quivar, who New York audiences are very familiar with through many appearances with the Metropolitan Opera over many seasons, also performances with the New York Philharmonic, concerts at Alice Tully Hall, and many others. And this has been a very busy year for you, the 93-94 season. Now, looking over all the places you've played, all the places you've performed, Los Angeles, San Francisco, the Metropolitan Opera, Carnegie Hall, Berlin, and many, many performances around Europe, too. An amazing year.
That's just the way you like it. You want those pages nice and full.
Yes,
yeah,
right.
No, it's been a great year, really. A lot of hopping back and forth. And for me, it's hard because it's not necessarily always with opera in Europe, and it's with concerts, so that I'm there maybe for 5 days, and then, boom, you pick up and you're in San Francisco, or you pick up and you're in Los Angeles, and that's hard.
Yeah, I bet. And originally we had planned that you would sing live for us today.
Yes.
But it's the middle of spring and
you've
the cherry blossoms are out and all the other blossoms are out.
Everything is out. I don't know. I guess because it was such a wet winter or something like that everything is just in full bloom. And I'm normally a very healthy person, but last week I was just taken back. So I decided not to sing today.
So a bit of hay fever.
Well, no, it's not hay fever. I don't have that, but it's just my sinuses. They're congested, and your head tones don't want to work, and the whole voice doesn't want to work. And because it is live, you don't have a chance to go back and do it again, which you don't in performances anyhow. I just opted to not sing today.
Sure, and we have lots of great recordings that we're going to hear throughout the hour, too, so that's okay.
Yeah,
but I wonder what that's like. I mean, I'm always a little bit in awe of a vocalist, just the fact that you are your instrument.
Right.
I mean, you have the most intimate relationship possible with your instrument.
Well, you travel with a pharmacy. I do. I mean, I have this, and I'm a little hypochondriac. Yes, I probably am. And you know, the night before performance, and it's, no, I feel, well, maybe I should take this, or I should take that, and then sometimes you take too much, and you're just dried out.
If a violinist blows out a bow, they can get a new one. And if a pianist breaks a damper, they can replace it. But that's not something you can do.
No, it's not. I mean, for instance, during this episode, I was going to my doctor, Dr. Braun, wonderful ear, nose, and throat specialist here in New York. And he'd look at the chords, and he said, the chords are beautiful. It's just your sinuses. So that you can work with. I mean, the sinuses heal. I go away tomorrow, and hopefully it is not as polluted, you know, in Indianapolis as it is here. And hopefully it'll pass, you know. And then I guess I'll become immune, so that when I come back in a week, then I won't be taken over again by the pollen.
Now, we were talking about the fact that you've been traveling all over the place, too. What kind of effect does that have on you if you're up in an airplane for hours and switching time zones?
Right.
All over the place.
I'm really lucky. If I'm sleepy, I can just sleep. I'm
great.
A night person, and I don't require a lot of sleep at night, maybe four hours. But during the day, if I get tired, I have to take, if it's no more, excuse me, just give me 10 minutes. And then I get 10 minutes of sleep, and then I'm refreshed.
But the
jet lagging, for instance, May, end of March, I was in Dresden, and we had just finished performances here with the Carmelites, and Heidi Grant Murphy was also in it, so she was jet lagging. We'd both just come in. And so we were there for a week, and from there I went straight to Los Angeles. And Europe went on the springtime a week before us. So when I arrived in L.A., I said, well, what time is it? I only had to take my watch 2 hours forward. I didn't really have jet lag that time.
That's amazing.
I didn't have jet lag.
Amazing.
But yet, when I came back to New York, then I was just off. Mm. And I would just wake up.
Just from L.A. to New York.
I guess it caught up with me. I don't know. And to go to Europe, I used to, you know, try to go to sleep. I would count sheep. I would do this. I would do that. And nothing happens other than to just let it happen. If you have to stay awake, what can you do? you know, you're frustrating yourself if you're trying to get to sleep, and then the next day you're not fresh. You catch up with it at some point.
You say you only need about 4 hours of sleep a night?
Normally.
That's amazing. I'm more like a 10-hour a night sort of person.
I'd
love
to sleep. I'd have a headache the next morning. I would. Yeah.
Well, I'm joined by Florence Quivar in our studios, mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar on Around New York. And tell us about this first recording we're going to hear. This is an excerpt from the Verdi Requiem.
Oh, right. I'm on two recordings of Verdi Requiem, which is really nice. The first was with Giulini, with Sharon Sweet, Vincent Cole, Simon Estes, and myself in Berlin Philharmonic. And this one is with Carol Vanesse, Carlo Colombaro, and Dennis Lewis, I think it is the tenor, and Colin Davis with the Bayerischer Symphony Orchestra on RCA.
And this is the Liber Scriptus from the Verdi Requiem, featuring mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar on Around New York.
Thank you.
an excerpt from the Verdi Requiem, the Liber Scriptus, featuring mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar, who was joined by the Bavarian Symphony Orchestra. Sir Colin Davis directed that performance, and that recording is on the RCA Victor label, and Florence Quivar is my guest on Around New York in the WNYC studios. Thanks again for coming and joining us on Around New York. We were talking during the break about the difference, the fact that you do both operatic performance and concert performances. And last week, tenor Chris Merritt was here, and, we had a little chat with him, and he was talking a little bit about the differences between those kinds of performances. And I wonder how that is for you, getting up in an opera in full costume with lots of movement and staging and the set around you. Is that distracting from the musical performance for you?
No.
Or does it add?
I mean, no. I think it adds.
The fact
it takes
that
on another dimension.
Gives you
go into
to
another
express.
Gear. You go into another gear of singing. During Carmelites, I was sitting there with Don Upshaw, and we were just sitting on the side of the stage. It was rehearsal week. And you look out, I mean, it's just overwhelming at this house, you know, probably the greatest house in the world. You're just sitting there on the stage, you know, this, what you call it? And I said, God, it's really such a blessing, you know. And she said, yeah, it is. And she says, you know, people say to me, you know, do you sing differently when you sing on this stage as opposed to singing, well, I guess, Carnegie or Avery Fisher? And she says, no, I don't. And I said, really? Another gear goes in. I don't know what it is, but it's something that gets, when you get, not necessarily that stage, but any house that's that size, it's something that mechanically goes on that you adjust because you're filling the size of this house.
So when you say another gear, you just mean working a little harder?
I can't describe that gear. I really can't. I mean, you know, what you sing in the studio, you sing it like this, and okay, that's fine. But once you get in that house, in any house, you get in the house and you get on the stage, another gear, something that you just automatically do.
Mm-hmm. And you were also saying that when you do an opera, you get to go off. And clear your throat and take a little break.
It was Ricky DiGiuseppe. We were doing Rossini Stop at Martyr down in Washington, D.C. a long time ago, and he said, I hate concert. He says, I don't have a tree. If there were a tree, I could turn up stage and clear my throat. I never thought about it that way. I'm just used, you know, you're just sitting there the whole time. But yeah, you are restricted because as we did, as they were playing that recording now, we could chit-chat. And otherwise, it's just straight on in a performance.
Now, we just heard an excerpt from your Verdi Requiem, and we have some other recordings that we're going to hear from a bit later. But you just finished a couple of new recordings that will be available soon. A Brahms
album, solo album.
And what will be on that one?
Well, I do the Zigeunerlieder by Brahms, the two songs for viola and voice and piano. My accompanist is Armin Guzalemian, and we recorded out in Los Angeles on Dallas Records. I sing probably about 20 Brahms songs, two of which we were going to do today. It's wonderful. I worked for years, for about 12 years, with Morinka Gurevich here in New York. And she was German, and I coach all the time with Martin Rich, who's also German. And they love Brahms and all of their singers. You know, I mean, Martina Royal is her own. Madame Gurevich was Martina's only teacher. Sharon Sweet is also a product of Gurevich. Everybody has this the Brahms songs. You know, everybody got the same things. So it was really, it was wonderful. And I went to Martin Rich, and we worked on them. And I laughed, and I said, because I would come from a lesson, and I'd go straight to him, and he would say, no, darling, you have to take the breath here. I said, but madam said that the breath goes here. No, I will call her, you know, and then they would have conversation over the phone. So this time, of course, she's gone, and I said to him, I says, listen, you have to argue with me now. I'm singing it. This is where I'm taking the breath.
So the Brahms album is one of the new releases.
Right.
That will be any idea when that will be coming out?
I think they're hoping to release it in the fall.
In the fall, mm-hmm. And also some Schumann.
Right. Yes, on DG Records with in Dresden, we recorded Paradis un Peri by Schumann.
Also out in the fall, hopefully?
I don't know.
Well, I guess that's up to Deutsche Grammophon, when it'll come out. We'll look for it. Florence Quivar, mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar, is my guest on this hour of Around New York. And you're talking a little bit about your studies, and I want to ask you about that. But let's hear some more music.
Okay.
An excerpt from the Guerrelieder of Schoenberg, Now, let's see, which excerpt is it we're going to hear here?
It ends the first act. It's the wood dove's aria. All that she sings, really, for the evening.
Stimme der Waldtaube, Tauba, is the excerpt from Der Guerrelieder, music by Arnold Schoenberg. Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar is my guest on Around New York. An excerpt from the Sony Classics recording of the Guerrelieder of Arnold Schoenberg. Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar joining Zubin Mehta and the New York Philharmonic. That was Stimme der Waldtraube. Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar is my guest in the studio on this hour of Around New York. A couple of times during that performance, during that recording, and during the previous recording, you were listening very critically to your own performance and making some critical comments. And I wonder, are you very critical of yourself when you listen to your recordings or after a concert?
I don't listen to them much. But the thing is when you're taping, you always go back and listen during the playback. And first of all, to see the quality of what they're using and if you're in really capable hands. And then for the most part, it's like, well, okay, I'm in good shape. But to actually sit down and listen to all of it during the... Yeah, I probably heard most of that. But then it doesn't matter because they may take a section from here. But there may have been something that went on in the orchestra part, and so they fuse it together. Mm. So that when you actually hear the recording, it's a combination of several things. Although that was supposedly a live recording, we still did it. We did it over in the studio. Mm.
And I know that building up to a concert or an operatic performance, there's so much energy, so much nervous energy, and so much expectation after it's all over.
Right.
How do you feel?
Yeah. Well, it's funny. I mean, it's always different. Sometimes you come off and it's, woo, you're alive, you know, you're great. And I mean, it doesn't matter on the quality of the performance, but this is a feeling, a sense that we work with, and the senses vary. So likewise, after a performance, your feelings vary. I mean, I've talked to friends and myself, I've come off and it was a fabulous performance and I'm depressed. Or I've come off and it wasn't, you know, and I'm ecstatic. So it just varies.
Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar is my guest on this hour of Around New York. Stay tuned. There's more in just a moment. I'm Fred Child, and this is Around New York on WNYC. Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar is my guest on this hour of the program. You're a very accomplished artist in your field. You've performed in all the great houses and all the great places, and yet you still study. You have coaches and people you work with all the time. How does that work? Someone who is at the top of her field, like yourself, still needs coaching and work on things.
Right. Well, I mean, for one, a lot of times you're learning new music. I can pretty much play Three Blind Mice on the piano, so I have to have somebody to work with me. The other thing is as a singer or any performer, you never get the chance to hear what you sound like. You know, you listen to a tape that's altered. You have to have ears of someone that you trust. And I have a few people that I really respect very much, and I work with them, and I coach all the time.
So some critical ears from the outside to give you feedback and
yes.
from people whose judgment you trust about your work.
Yes.
So that's always an ongoing thing.
Always. Mm-hmm. I mean, when I come home, I say, well, I have to come back because I have to work. And work at what? Work at learning my music. Mm-hmm. I've just been working with Valery Rivkin, and he's Russian. I first worked with him working Russian music. But he's so accomplished in German. He's so accomplished in Italian. And he's a great coach. I mean, he really, really listens. Sometimes you'll get a coach who just sits there and they'll let you sing, but he really listens. You didn't do that dot at this, or you didn't do this, or the pronunciation. That's what you're paying your money for. I'm taking the time, so they need to take the time too.
Right. Now, we were originally planning that you would be performing live with us on the program today, and just because of all the pollen that's out and this spring, we weren't able to do that.
Right.
And you told me a story that when we were off mic about the amazing things that this doctor that you went to did to help you out. And I was wondering if you could share this.
Actually, what we were just talking about is there are no commercials. I've been
right. It's public radio.
That's right. Dr. Braun is his name on East 60th Street, right up the street from Bloomingdale. So if you're a little late, you can go shopping and then you can come back to the doctor. But he's a marvelous doctor, ear, nose, and throat doctor. He worked at one point with Dr. Eugene Grapscheid, who was the leading throat doctor here in New York, and he died several years ago. And what I like about Dr. Braun is that he doesn't over-medicate. You know, I mean, I went, and I'm hypochondriac, I admit it, and he'll say, well, Florence, you know, I think, you know, just use the nasal line and use, isochlor or whatever, rather than a lot of doctors will give you cortisone, or they'll give you, you know, the prescriptions are already written out, and they just tear it off the tab and give it to you. You don't need that. It dries you out even more.
There was some sort of vacuum.
Right, that's what I was going to get to. And mine is sinuses, and they're just all clogged. And he has a spray, and he sprays the nose, and he lets that go down, and you already feel relief. And then he has a vacuum that actually goes into the sinus area, and it drains a lot of the mucus out, and boom, your head just opens up like that without medication.
And how long does that hold? How long does that last?
Maybe through the night.
So you might do it before a performance?
I haven't done that. No, I did it the night before, like last week, and we did the Das Lied, and they were really bad. And so I went to him, and he says, well, no, I don't want to give you this. I don't want to give you that. And he did that. And then the next day, I took another pill and rested. You know, total vocal rest is one of the best therapies, really. It's just to totally be quiet.
Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar is our guest on Around New York on WNYC. And we have one more recording to hear from an album called Ride On King Jesus, an album of black music from America. Now, did you grow up singing in the church? Is that how you got your start?
Yeah, well, I didn't sing in the church. I wasn't a heathen, but my mother was a organist and pianist, and she had 60 or 70 students teaching piano and voice, and my sister and I also studied. And all of our friends, and every spring, we did a concert, and you learned a new piece, both piano and voice. So that's where I really started. I was 6 years old, and I sang a solo in the church. But she had choruses that trained there in the house. I was around music all my life. But these are all songs that my mom taught me.
The CD is called Ride On King Jesus, and I think we're going to hear the title track.
Right, Ride On King Jesus. I think we're doing the one arranged by Hall Johnson.
And are you joined by the Harlem Boys Choir?
In this particular song, no.
No, on the rest of the album, the Harlem Boys Choir.
Right, they're on six of them.
Larry Woodard.
Woodard,
at the piano. From the CD Ride On King Jesus, featuring mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar.
No works, no.
Ride On, King Jesus is the name of the tune and the name of the CD as well on the Angel EMI label. Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar with Larry Woodard at the piano and joined elsewhere on that CD by the Harlem Boys Choir. Florence Quivar, thank you so much for coming in and joining us on Around New York during this hour. You have a couple of things coming up that we wanted to mention.
Right, particularly here in New York, recital May the 7th at Alice Tully Hall, next year, obviously, and the opening season for the Met, Il Tabarro, I do Frugola, and the summer, Adriana Lecouvre in Buenos Aires.
Great. So, let's see. Today is May 9th. That's May 7th next year. So,
yeah.
363 days from now at the Met.
Look at how much time I have to prepare.
Mezzo-soprano Florence Quivar. Thank you so much for joining us on Around New York.
Thanks. It was my pleasure.